Hello, Landing Crew family. Today we are going to talk about sensory disorder and treats. Now, if you're new here, hello.
Hi,
my name is Stephanie. Once a week, I try to do an autism educational video. The rest of the week is just kind of hodgepodge, some vlogs of our family as 4 of 6 of our kids are autistic. With that said though, today's video actually is not about autism. It's about sensory. You can have sensory issues or even be diagnosed with sensory processing disorder and not have autism, but usually if you are autistic, you are going to more likely gonna have sensory issues. A lot of times though, sensory processing disorder is the first diagnosis given to an autistic child before the diagnosis of autism. That's why a lot of parents and caregivers automatically think autism when a child starts showing some sensory issues, but that is not always the case. If you've ever heard the term sensory seeker, sensory avoider, it presents very different. And so that is why the list for sensory traits is very, very long. A sensory seeker is a child that is considered undersensitive, and a sensory avoider is a child that is considered overly sensitive. Can a child have both though? Absolutely, a child can have both. Now, as I said at the beginning, I have 4 autistic children. They're all affected by sensory issues. My oldest, Noah, he is a sensory avoider. Lex, he is both. He's a sensory avoider and a sensory seeker. My almost 4-year-old Liam, he's a sensory seeker. And then my 2.5-year-old, she is, I don't know, I feel like she's kind of half and half too. I feel like she avoids more than C. There is no known cause for sensory processing disorder. Yes, it can go hand in hand with other diagnoses that might have a cause for that diagnosis, but there's no actual known cause. Genetics can play a big part, absolutely. If you have a parent that has sensory issues, the chances of you having a child that has sensory issues are probably a lot higher, right? It's the same thing with autism. But there's no actual explanation. So we are going to split this up into sensory seeker and sensory avoider. Let's be respectful and kind to everyone and anyone that comments anything saying, well, every child does this, you're gonna be blocked, because this is a place for parents and caregivers to come for support and love. Yes, just because a child does a few of these things does not mean they have sensory processing disorder. But if your child is checking a lot of these boxes, then it's definitely worth checking out. And we aren't going to invalidate what other children are going through or what other parents are experiencing with their children just because you haven't taken the time to understand disabilities and special needs and how they present and how the diagnosing process goes. You can have sensory issues and not have sensory processing disorder. There's a difference. It's like saying someone has autistic traits versus someone having an autism diagnosis. So sensory seeker, they might have trouble sitting still. They could be a thrill seeker. So maybe they kind of misjudge a lot of like high places. Some of these things obviously are going to be kid appropriate. Like jumping out of a tree is probably going to be kid appropriate. It is how high they're jumping and if they seem to be recognizing the sense of danger. It's very, very common for them to have a lowered sense of danger. They can spin without getting dizzy. They've actually done research and there's an actual word for it. Will and Emily son, Sawyer from It's Our Wonderful Life. I know that we have some people that follow them. If you follow them, you know what I'm talking about. Like he can just like spin and spin and spin and spin. They might be someone who really loves jumping. They're just constantly on the move. I feel like with sensory seekers, they're just on the go a lot. They prefer water to a dangerous level. So it's not like, oh, I enjoy swimming. Most kids enjoy swimming. They don't understand the dangers around the water. So I'll give my daughter as an example. Like she can literally stay in the bathtub all day long. She isn't swimming and doing things that 2-year-olds would do. She literally just sits there and stims on the water like for an hour. She's not having appropriate play with it. When we took them to the water park over the summer. Now remember, my almost 4-year-old, he's a sensory seeker. Both of them were literally trying to jump out of my husband and I's arms while we were on a bridge to jump into the water. A sensory seeker will probably struggle with personal space. They might stand too close. The spatial concept might be really hard for them. Might chew on things a lot. Our 5-year-old, he chews on everything. We have a little chewy if you've seen it in vlogs. We got that because he was chewing through every single shirt. Like if he had a shirt on for 10 minutes, he would chew through it. And it literally looked like it had been torn up by a dog. That can definitely be a sign, right? Especially if they're at an older age, If they're one or two, that probably isn't too abnormal. But once you're getting closer to kindergarten age, that's when it's definitely a little bit more questionable. Something else with sensory seeking, they can sometimes harm smaller children than them and animals just because they don't understand their own strength, basically. They're not trying to be mean. They aren't trying to be cruel. There is this really big idea that if a young child is mean to an animal, that they must be a sociopath. That is not necessarily true in the sensory and autism space, because a lot of times it isn't necessarily that they're trying to be cruel. As always, if you have any concerns for your child, then please talk to their physician. I also don't want parents thinking just because their four-year-old is having a hard time being able to pet a cat or pet a dog without being too rough, that now they're worried about their child having like a severe mental illness. Another sign, Pinky, be constant touching and squeezing. Liam does this where he basically like rolls his entire body all over you because they're really needing pressure. I could do a whole different video on how to address sensory issues, but when Liam's doing that, we know that we need to take the time and either put him between cushions or squeeze him. That's him telling us that he needs squeezes. He is essentially nonverbal, and that's his way of communicating with us. Sensory seekers also seek visual stimulation, usually through TV and tablets. There's a lot of criticism and critique about kids being on tablets, especially like in the autism space with sensory issues, but it's also because it's something that is stimulating them as well, so they're naturally just drawn to it. Kids that are sensory seekers usually have a high pain tolerance. They might prefer certain textures like slime and Play-Doh. They also may not recognize when their face is dirty or their nose is running. Now, the face is dirty, I feel like most kids could care less, but usually if a child has a runny nose, they can usually feel it. So we do talk about younger kids a lot just because that's kind of the space. That's when we kind of start realizing that things may not be typical or follow the typical developmental path for them. But this can also affect older kids as well. I am 35 years old and I definitely have sensory issues. I am a lot like Nelly. I'm mainly a sensory avoider with a little bit of sensory seeking. I love roller coasters and swings, but in older kids, this can cause a lot of confidence and self-esteem issues because you have to think it from their point of view. Once they get older, they realize that they're different, and there's a lot of processing that goes on when you're neurodivergent. It may show up more as like social anxiety and depression. So just kind of be aware of that as they get older. So that is a sensory seeker. The next is a sensory avoider. Now, both of them have their own set of problems. I don't feel like one is better than the other. A lot of parents that have a sensory avoider wishes they have a sensory seeker and vice versa. But a sensory seeker can be very dangerous. Like, they have such a low level of danger awareness, but sensory avoiders, a lot of things bother them. So it makes it hard to be able to go out and do things. Like Lex being more of a seeker than an avoider, we can take him to the store with minimal issues. But Noah, our 14-year-old, it's always been hard to take him out in public. Some signs that you might have a sensory avoider is they might struggle with clothing texture, tags. The socks might have to be a certain way. Here's a little tip. If your child does have issues with socks being on the normal way because the seam is on the inside and touching their feet, then just turn the socks inside out. You don't have to buy like a special type of sock. I feel like that's the easiest solution. That is something we learned with Noah at a very young age. They may not like bright lights. They may have a very low pain tolerance. So a sensory seeker, they can handle a lot of pain. A sensory avoider, light touches may cause them pain. So when Noah was three, he was our first special needs child, right? And so we would always rub our kids' head to put them to bed, and we would do it with Noah. And he would scream and scream that we were hurting him. We knew nothing about autism, nothing about sensory. We had one of our neighbors come over because we lived in an apartment. She was obviously very concerned. I had to show her that Lonnie was just, you know, rubbing his head. That was such a hard part for us because we didn't understand it. The best way to explain it is it feels painful. Even though it's not painful, it feels painful. Bath time may be very hard with them. They may dislike showers and rain. I still have a really hard time with taking showers and rain. I still take baths 90% of the time. These aren't things that you outgrow. Your child will just learn how to tolerate different different things in life, basically. I've talked about this, but noises that don't seem loud to you but feel loud to them unless they're controlling it. If they're controlling it, then it may be extremely louder. And that's why it's very confusing to a lot of parents and caregivers. Like, soft touches feel hard. I gave a perfect example of that. Another one is brushing hair, brushing teeth. That is why hygiene is so hard for sensory avoiders. Liam, our almost 4-year-old, he laughs when we brush his teeth. Toe walking can also sometimes be a sign of sensory as well. Food textures could make them gag, or they may not even want to touch certain foods. My 2-year-old, she has hard times like even picking up a potato or a french fry because it has that gritty texture. So there's just some things that they just may not be able to eat or touch. They might avoid things like Play-Doh, kinetic sand, slime. Our 2-year-old, again, she like just like pushes at it. She wants to play with it. Like, the Play-Doh looks fun and in theory she wants to, but she just like barely touches it and then just can't do it. She just can't do it. A sensory avoider might have like poor balance, fall down a lot. Now, this could of course be because of low tone as well. They may really dislike swings, just like roller coasters. Noah still won't get on a swing. He doesn't even like going on like the Peter Pan ride at Disney World, even the ones that are like so slow, like Winnie the Pooh. We had to like convince him to go on. It's like a fear of heights, even if there's no real danger. So it's one thing if you're taking them on the mountain, right? Like, that's gonna be scary, but it's where there is no danger. You can see that there's no danger, but they just can't get over that feeling of it. They may be a child that avoids cuddles and hugs. Noah does a little bit better. He will give us a hug every night before he goes to bed, but it's a very light hug. But he would ask me to cuddle with him when he was younger, and he didn't mean cuddle. His cuddling was us laying side by side. And at first I remember it kind of bothered me because I was new to all of this and I just wanted to cuddle with my son. I thought he didn't like me or something. It took me some time to realize that this was his way of showing affection, even though it didn't look like how I thought it would look like. But there are some days where he just can't be touched. I relate with that a lot too. There are some days like my husband goes to hug me or love on me and it feels like there's bugs crawling under my skin and that it's like physically painful. It sucks. They may like dislike sudden sounds or movements. So like suddenly grabbing them is too much for them. Toilets flushing, especially in public restrooms, is like a huge no, but I think they're loud anyway. Like, some are so loud. I'm like, do you not have like a volume control on that? Usually you're gonna see more behavioral issues with sensory avoiders than seekers. And you're usually gonna see these behavior issues when they are sensory overload, basically, when they are overstimulated. You're gonna see these behaviors in the grocery store, in public, when they've been pushed too hard, theme parks. So the biggest things that sensory issues causes problems with is awareness of safety. Hygiene is a really big one, especially if they're an avoider, and just going in public places. These are the three things that I see most often with kids, is just being able to integrate daily life where you are needing to be able to stay safe, where you are needing to be able to take care of yourself or go out in public. It is exhausting. Whenever I have like a big day where I have to be out in public a lot, I just basically shut down when I get home because it's just a lot. So what are some of the things that can help with sensory? Occupational therapy works on fine motor skills, daily living skills, sensory. They overlap with a lot of therapies, but OT, occupational therapy, is usually the treatment plan for sensory disorder. Most of our ABA programs are actually built off of what OT says because it is such a vast range. That's how we do it. Everyone's gonna do it differently, but our kids' ABA programs are mainly built off of what OT, PT, and speech suggests, or anything that we want to put in there. This is where it's my opinion, so take this lightly. I don't feel that forcing a child to get used to a texture that they don't like is really conducive. It's okay that Penelope never wants to pick up a french fry. Like, she's gonna be completely okay. We have other foods to eat besides potatoes, so I don't think it's that big of a deal. I don't feel that children should have to be basically tortured in order to conform to society. There are some things though that just to live and go through life and being at your best independence, you do have to go through. So one of our children really, really struggle with bath time. Actually, two do. They really struggle with just bath time. And so we've really had to work on that. That is something that, yeah, you do have to get used to that because you do have to bathe. So I think it's choosing, like, is this going to increase their independence, or is this just something that I'm choosing? And then the other side of it is also giving them a sensory diet of giving them outlets to let that out. So for Liam, it's him knowing that he has a swing or he has a place where he can shut everything off. Penelope has sensory noodles. Stimming can also be another sign of sensory as well. I don't know why I didn't include that, but it can definitely be a sign of sensory. It's access to these things to be able to live their best life. Sometimes this can even be like breaks in the day to either swing or walk, jump on the trampoline, whatever it is, and just giving them that sensory input or output that they're needing. There's also these like cushions. We got one at Walmart, but they're like the cushions that move, where they can just move and not have to stay still for the entire time. Another sign of sensory that I don't think I put on here, sometimes it can be them pinching or grabbing like that, because that is sensory. Ow. That is it on sensory. I hope you guys enjoyed this. Again, if you're new, feel free to hit that red subscribe button. We would love for you to be a part of our family, and we'll see you guys next time.
Where you move, make me blind. You will always be there. There's no doubt in my mind. You will always be there.